So since I last talked 2 weeks ago, I thought maybe I'll start with a quick review of what we did, in particular about rigidity results. All right, so here is a there was a review of what are the main properties of Kerr spaces. Right, so it's vacuum, there is a Killing vector field which is time-like at infinity, asymptotic flatness, global hyperbolicity, completeness, in particular completeness of scry, and then of course there is a second Killing vector field in the case of Kerr, and of course Kerr is also real analytic, a black hole, a more general black hole in vacuum is one that satisfies the first three properties, all right? So that's here's how a stationary black hole looks like, the external part, right? So we have the horizon, which is this, past and future. We have a bifurcate sphere here, which corresponds to the non-extremal case. We have the time-like Killing vector field, which near scry, so near infinity, it looks time-like, but of course it becomes space-like near the horizon. That's the ergo region, where GTT is negative. And of course we also have a lot of trapped null geodesics, which play a role, as we shall discuss. Okay, so the rigidity conjecture, the Kerr family, exhausts all stationary asymptotically flat regular vacuum black holes. It's true in the static case, true in the axially symmetric case by Carter Robinson. That's a famous and beautiful result. And then true in general under an analyticity assumption made by Hawking. And as we discussed last time, the analyticity is very unreasonable. It makes no sense in the ergo region, because in the ergo region, the Einstein equations become actually hyperbolic rather than elliptic, and the analyticity makes no sense. So there are some other recent results, more recent results on in when you don't assume analyticity. So first one is a result that I had with Ionescu that if it coincides with Kerr just on the bifurcate sphere, right? So the only assumption you make on the bifurcate sphere, if it coincides with Kerr, that it must be Kerr everywhere. So that was one result. And then the other result, which is more satisfying, is that it's true if it's close to a Kerr space-time. So in other words, if you have a stationary solution which is sufficiently close to Kerr, then it must be Kerr. So this is a result, a perturbation result, which is at least consistent with the stability of the Kerr space-time, which we shall discuss later on. So at least it's satisfactory from that point of view. But of course, the full result is not known. So as we discussed, the reason we have difficulties is because it's very easy to show that there exists a second Killing vector field. Hawking proved that on the horizon. But to extend it away from the horizon, you need to solve an ill-posed problem. So ill-posed problems make no sense in the analytic regime. Are trivial in the analytic regime, but are difficult in the non, in the smooth regime. Okay, this was what I showed you last time, that you cannot extend. So the main new ideas in these results are, first of all, the fact that you can characterize the Kerr spacetime by the vanishing of a tensor, which is a Ford tensor, which is a Mars-Simon tensor. We'll discuss more about this later on. And then you have another idea, which was to find a way to extend the Killing vector field from the horizon in the interior, and then show by unique continuation, show that it must coincide. It must be Killing. So you extend it. You extend it by some vector field method, transport type method. So normally it should not be Killing, but you check that it's Killing by a unique continuation argument. So that's something we'll discuss in a second. And then, of course, you have pseudo convexity or null convexity, rather, which I prefer to call it. Remember that the null convexity is defined relative to the metric. So you look at the Lorentz metric, and you say that if you have a domain in your manifold and the point in the boundary of the domain, right, so you have a point in the boundary of the domain, then you say that the null convexity condition is satisfied if the second, the Hessian of f, f is a defining function at the boundary. So f is zero at the boundary and it's negative in the interior of the domain O. So, and you look at the point in the boundary. So I look at the point in the boundary and I want this to be negative for all null vector fields which are tangent to the boundary. Actually, this should be the boundary here. And which are null. Okay? It's also T null convexity if, in addition, you are restricting yourself to vector fields which are perpendicular to T. So this is a T null convexity condition. Without this condition, then it's just the standard null convexity condition. Okay? All right. For a defining function F at P. Okay. So that's, and somehow the point is that on the bifurcate sphere, this T convexity condition is verified. Of course, a bifurcate sphere is not smooth, so you have to be a bit careful. But roughly, the idea is that at this point, this T convexity condition is verified. And therefore, unique continuation will allow you to extend the vector field. To extend, well, we'll see. OK, so so here is a result which I'm going to talk about. It's the journal. Okay, so I'll talk more about this in a second, so let me go over this. Okay, so now let's look at these issues more in depth. So, again, recall Kerr space-time stationary black holes, rigidity conjecture and results. Okay, so here is the global extension, a local extension result, which is very general, and which I mentioned last time. Okay, so let's go carefully over the definition here. So first of all, we have a Ricci flat pseudo-Riemannian manifold. So the metric doesn't even have to be Lorentzian. It's a general pseudo-Riemannian, right? It's non-degenerate. That's the only thing you need. It's a non-degenerate metric. You have a domain in M, right? So this is an open set in M, and you have a Koenig vector field Z in the domain, and I want to extend Z outside the domain. Okay, so I have a boundary, right? So I have the boundary of O. I have a point in the boundary, and I want to extend Z in a neighborhood, right? So the picture looks like this. So you have a domain. This is your manifold M. This is O, point P, and a vector field Z, which in particular is defined here, which is Killing. So it's Killing inside. And I want to extend it outside past the point P, right? And we have a function here, a defining function H, such that H, of course, is 0. So H is 0 on the boundary of the domain O. And H is negative in O, right? So that's the definition of a defining function. Okay, so that's the situation. I want to extend the vector field. Now, if the manifold is analytic, then it's trivial to extend. So it's an old known, a well-known result that gives you, in the case of analyticity, gives you even global extensions without any problem. So there is no issue. In fact, that's exactly the result that Hawking used in order to prove his rigidity theorem. Right? So in the non-analytic case, however, it's not enough. There is no general result. In fact, it's not true. If I have a general manifold and such a Koenig vector field in general, I cannot extend. There is no extension. Okay? We'll find counterexamples. We'll discuss counterexamples later on. So I have to assume that the Einstein equations are satisfied. Right? So Einstein vacuum equations are satisfied. Right? So Ricci flat. So Ricci flat is essential. Without it, you don't have the result. OK, even this is not enough. You need another condition. You need H to satisfy the null convexity condition. Null convexity condition. OK, so that's the kind of result that we are going to prove. So again, this is strongly null convex at p, right? Strongly null convex means exactly that h instead of h, saying that h verifies the null convexity condition is of course the same, is equivalent to saying that DO is null convex at p. Okay, so and of course if it's null convex at p, by the way, null convexity is always strict null convexity, right? It has to be, the inequality has to be strictly larger than zero, right? The inequality of the Hessian d2 of h, let me recall. So the condition, so this means that d2 h of xx is strictly negative for every x in the tangent space at O, at the boundary of O, and gxx null. Okay? Right. So of course, for example, if you have a Riemannian manifold, then this null convexity condition is automatically verified. Right? So this is interesting only in the non-Riemannian case. All right. Okay, so strong null convexity. Then Z extends as a Killing vector field to a neighborhood of P. Okay? So the result is that you have extension. Okay, but only under those conditions. So for example, this null convexity condition, if you have equality here, the result is false. And we shall see counterexamples later on. All right. So this is, again, the same definition of null convexity. Right? So x is tangent and null, then the Hessian of f, the Hessian of h, actually. I don't know why I have f here. Anyway, defining function f or defining function h, it's the same thing. Okay, so that's, is that clear? Any questions about this? Okay, so these are the assumptions. Now we have to prove it. So how do you prove it? So obviously I'm not going to go through the whole proof, but I think it's a very nice result in that the ideas are very, very relatively simple and very convincing. The calculations are a little more difficult to do, but the ideas are very, very clear. So here's how you do it. You start with, the first thing that you do is you try to extend the vector field somehow, and you are going to extend it by using null geodesics. Okay? So actually not null geodesics, just geodesics, in fact. So in other words, I'm considering a vector field which is transverse to the boundary and which is geodesic. DLL is equal to zero, right? So, and of course this generates geodesics, right? So all I want to do is to get some geodesics across the boundary, right? Because I want to extend Z along these geodesics, right? So this is the first thing. So of course this is the local result, so I just have to do it in the neighborhood of a point. Then I extend Z, so this is the main point here. I want to extend Z by verifying a transport equation. In fact, this is a Jacobi equation. So the second covariant derivative of Z in direction of L is equal to RLZ. So R is a curvature tensor. So this is a vector, right? You take the curvature tensor and you multiply by LZ and L, so you get a vector at the end, which is, and here of course you also have a vector. So this is the standard Jacobi equation, right? So Z verifies, in other words, a transport equation, so you can always solve it, of course, right? So I start with Z here, so I know Z here on the boundary, right? Because I know Z all the way up to the boundary. And I just extend it. In fact, even I can start even a little bit before the boundary, right? That's not an issue. So Z can always be extended like this. All right. So, but of course, the extension is not necessarily Killing. There is no reason to assume that this would be a Killing vector field, right? It's just an extended vector field which happens to coincide with Z in O, but that's it, right? Okay. So now I want to prove that it's actually Killing, so I have to do something. So what I do is, first of all, I take the lead derivative of Z relative to Z of the metric G. So of course, if Z was Killing, this should be zero, right? So in particular, pi is going to be zero here. So the deformation tensor will be zero here, but not necessarily zero here, right? Okay, so I have to show that pi is zero, but I cannot show that pi is zero if I don't show at the same time much more. If I don't show at the same time that the lead derivative of the curvature is also zero. Okay, so I look at the lead derivative, so I take also the lead derivative with respect to z of the Riemann curvature tensor. Right. Now the Riemann curvature tensor in a flat, in the case when reach is equal to zero, is of course a Weyl field. Weyl field means all the a tensor which is a four tensor which verifies all the symmetry properties of the Riemann curvature tensor, and in addition is trace free, right? Doesn't have a trace. Now, if I just take Li z of r, I'm not going to get the symmetries will still be true, but the trace will not necessarily be true. So I need to make a modification. And the modification is made by subtracting some product between a tensor B, which I'm going to define, and the curvature tensor. So this is a very standard, it's very easy to define this. It's just B times R in the simplest possible way. But B, you see, I could take B to be just 1/2 pi. In fact, in the stability of Minkowski space, we use this idea, where we took B to be just 1/2 pi, and that will ensure that you have something which is traceless, that W will be traceless. But it turns out that we need something more here. I need to also take an anti-symmetric tensor, which has to be appropriately defined. And it turns out that that anything here, because of the anti-symmetry, anything which I add here, which is anti-symmetric, will automatically imply that W is a Weyl field. So W is a Weyl field. So this thing here is a Weyl field. For any omega, okay? Any omega is again an anti-symmetric two tensor. So pi is a two tensor omega, but symmetric, and this is anti-symmetric. Okay, so now here is one simple remark which follows immediately from this. The pi, which is a deformation tensor, in the direction of L is zero. Okay, so that's an easy check, but it's very important. So you check that. Then you define something at the level of derivatives of pi. So I take, and you'll see why. I'll explain this in a second. But I need. So in other words, it's not enough to look at just pi and w. I need some intermediary tensor, as we shall see. So what you do next is you define this covariant derivative of pi. So it's d alpha of pi beta mu minus d beta pi alpha mu. But I subtract this covariant derivative of this omega, which for the moment is free, right? Omega is just an anti-symmetric two tensor. I define this p rho to be the trace of p alpha w mu, so this is standard. But now I make a choice of omega. I choose it to verify this equation. Okay, so dl of w is pi times d beta of l minus pi times d alpha of l. And of course, I choose it again. So this is an ordinary differential equation. It's a transport equation. I choose again my initial condition to be zero in O, right? So I take omega to be zero in O, which is obviously consistent with what I'm trying to prove. Now, the reason you make this choice is because I want this P to verify a similar property as pi. In other words, L times P should be zero. Okay, so this, and of course, L times W should also be zero. So it turns out that this definition is such that these two will be satisfied. So again, it's a simple check, but it's very important. All right, now comes something very important, a very important calculation. You see, W, I want W to verify some equation. Now, of course, I know a priori, I know from Bianchi identities. So if I look at Bianchi identities, equal to zero, and R alpha gamma equal to zero, it follows from these two that d beta R alpha, so d mu R mu alpha beta gamma is equal to zero. So this is a very simple fact, right? Which follows immediately from Ricci flat. So this is a nice equation. It's like a Maxwell equation, in fact. It turns out that these two really give you some kind of Maxwell equation, some kind of wave equation. And that is going to be very important. But of course, I don't want r. It's not r that I'm trying to show that it's 0. I want to show that least z of r is equal to 0. Okay? So I have to commute this equation with least z. Okay? But since z is not killing, of course, wherever z is killing, we know that the Lie derivative with respect to a killing vector field commutes with covariant derivatives. Right? So if z was killing, I would get immediately d mu of Lie z r is equal to 0. Right? Okay, but of course, z is not killing. And instead, I'm going to get here a deformation tensor pi times r plus d pi times r. So in other words, some kind of algebraic terms which are of this type, either pi multiplied by curvature or derivative of pi, sorry, times derivative of curvature, or derivative of pi times curvature. So these are the kind of terms that you get. So you get lots of terms like this. And if you organize them nicely, you see, in fact, that you get this equation, which I have down, right? So W is like Lie z of r, but with a modification. If I keep track of the modification, I get that on the right-hand side, instead of pi times derivative of r, I get b times derivative of r, and then I get a p times r and p times r. So instead of d pi, I'm getting this p, which is nice, because p is a quantity that I will be able to control. Right? Okay, so far, so good. So this is nothing else. This calculation here is essentially the calculation of commuting Lie derivatives with covariant derivatives and generating terms which are deformation tensor, depend on the deformation tensor of z, in other words, pi. Okay, so again, this is just a calculation. It's not too difficult. Okay, conceptually, it's very clear. All you do is to commute Lie z with covariant derivative of r.
So the fact that we reach that was only used in this computation.
Yeah, right, exactly. But this is extremely important. It comes up somewhere else, I don't remember, but yeah. But this is very important, otherwise you don't get an equation. All right, so any questions about this? Right. Okay, so these are all simple identities. Okay, but now here comes up a next important step. You see, I have here a W. This is like a wave equation. So this is nice, because I want to have a wave equation for which I can apply then unique continuation, right? I want to show that W is 0 by a unique continuation argument. So what I have on the left is quite nice. But on the right, I have a B and a P. But I don't control, for the moment, I don't control them. I only control P in this direction. But of course, I get all the components of P and all the components of B, which I don't control yet. Right? So I need another identity, in fact, two other identities, which are these ones here. So I prove that the derivative with respect to L of B, right? So B, remember, B was just this quantity. And W, I had an equation for W, so anyway, it's not too hard to check this one. So this is actually very easy. So you see, the derivative with respect to L of B is proportional to P, and again, B again. So that's good, because this is like a transport equation in B, but of course I have the P now. Right, I have also P on the right. So I need also an equation for P. So it turns out that the derivative, so this is a little bit more complicated, but it's a very nice identity. It turns out that the derivative of P with respect to L can be expressed in terms of W. So this is a Weyl field, which I now control. Right, so I like this. I like this term. And I like B because B is here. And I like the P because P is here. So you see, this now, modulo the W, this is a well-defined transport equation in P and B. So it's a system of four differential equations P and B, but of course with W here, right? So W is a source. So again, if I don't control W, I have nothing, right? So the important thing is that for W, I have this other identity, which I wrote before. So you see, I have an identity for W. So this is the wave equation expressed on the right-hand side in terms of B and P. But B and P themselves are expressed in terms of B and P and W. So I get a closed system of equations. Okay. So now I differentiate again the W. I get a wave equation for W. That's very easy. If I get an equation for this, I also get an equation for the D'Alembertian of R. So it's very easy to check But if I take one more derivative, I get an equation. In particular, I'm interested in W. So it's very easy to get an equation for W, a wave equation. And this is what you get. You see, the wave equation, I mean, obviously, the wave equation, if you think differentiating once more, you are going to get derivative of B and derivative of P. So you expect those to be present. So the wave equation will be proportional. M means just that M is a tensor, some arbitrary tensor multiplied with this B, dBs, and so on and so forth, right? So it's a proportionality identity. Identity that tells you that what is on the left-hand side is proportional to all these terms on the right-hand side. Okay, so in other words, it's going to be a linear combination of all these terms with some coefficients which themselves are tensors, right? But we don't care. The important thing is that they are proportional to these things. And the transport equation are like this. DL of B is proportional to B dot is DL. So it's proportional to B, B dot, P, and W. DL of B dot, which is DL of B, is proportional to this. DL of P is proportional to this. Okay? So you get now a closed system of ordinary differential equations, which are these ones, but with a source W. And the source verifies a wave equation with, again, sources on the right-hand side, which may depend on all these things. So this is a closed system now. And the point now is to use unique continuation. So you see, what unique continuation allows you to do in the simplest case, it allows you to do, you see, suppose, so let's look again at this picture. So I have O and Z, and I have a point P. Right? And I have null convexity here. And I get an equation, let's say, D'Ambertian, with respect to the metric, right? So I'm in a on a manifold MG. And again, this is pseudo-Riemannian. It doesn't have to be the usual D'Ambertian, right? So this is, D'Ambertian just means D alpha, D alpha, okay? This operator in the covariant sense, right? So let's say, let's look at the scalar equation. Just, this is, of course, much more complicated, but let's simplify and just look at the scalar equation. Let's assume that I have only a multiple of phi and derivative of phi on the right-hand side, right? Something very simple like this. So the ambition with respect to phi is equal to m phi times derivative of phi. And I know that phi is 0 here. I look at the neighborhood. I know that I'm 0 here. I know that the wave equation is verified in the full neighborhood. In fact, I know that phi is 0 here, right? Because everything that was constructed in O was, of course, was trivially 0 because my Killing vector field was, my original vector field Z was Killing here. So all the quantities which come there are 0 in O, right? All these quantities, P, W, and so on and so forth, are 0 in O, right? So we know that the boundary conditions are verified. And but I also have a wave equation, let's say, like this. And I have null pseudo-convexity. So this implies that phi is equal to 0 on the right, right? So in a neighborhood of P. Right? So this is a highly non-trivial fact, right? I mean, it's by no means trivial. And of course, it uses this null convexity of the boundary. If the null convexity is not verified, this result is false. Okay? So once you have this, of course, you have to work a little bit harder because, I mean, these equations are much more complicated than just the scalar wave equation. But it doesn't really matter too much. It turns out that you can write down coordinates, and somehow the problem can be reduced to scalar equations coupled with ordinary differential equations. But the ordinary differential equations are no problem because they are well posed anyway. I mean, there is no issue, right? So it's only the wave equation that can have this problem of unique continuation. The ordinary differential equations part just go for the ride, right? So when you prove, you have to prove some non-trivial estimates in order to get these sort of things. When you prove it for the wave equations, you might as well prove it for a coupled system of wave equations with ordinary differential equations. Okay, so that's not, again, that's not an issue. So if you have unique continuation, in other words, if I have a unique continuation for this operator, the essential part is here. If I have unique continuation for this, then everything else. I have unique continuation for everything, and therefore I conclude that all the quantities here are zero in a neighborhood of the point P, and I'm done. Okay. Okay. So that's sort of the schematically that's the proof. The calculations are not too difficult. I mean, once you know the ideas, you can, I'm sure you can all do them yourself. There is one more identity, however, that I want to draw your attention to, because it's a nice general identity. And it turns out to be very useful in other things. So you see, it's in order to derive this equation, I have to do some work. So it turns out that if I look at a P prime defined without the omega was an anti-symmetric form, defined only in terms of the deformation terms of Z, right? So it's only this part. So it turns out, so again, I mean, this is a very general fact. Given any vector field, Z, it doesn't have to be Killing, of course, I define the pi, and then I define the P according to this. Then the p's verify this curl-type equation. The d derivative of p minus derivative of p is Li derivative. This is very important because I want to connect the p, I want to connect to the w. And this is how I make the connections through this identity. And the identity is something that, again, you just check. But once you know it for life, right? So that's good to put it on your dictionary of interesting identities. Okay, is that okay?
So right. Why do you use the Jacobian
version? Why did I use it? Well, you need an equation to extend, and we found that to be the nicest one, the most general one that we could find. I mean, there are other ways of extending, of course, but this was the most general one. I mean, so there are sort of technical reasons why. I mean, because indeed you could have extended in a simpler way. But it turns out that this extension is more general. It allows you to treat the most general case. Remember, I don't make any other assumptions. I just take a general Killing vector field, and I extend it. Right. So. Okay. So anyway. So that's. Any other questions? Yes.
Let's say the remaining case, if the boundary always comes back, you get a neighborhood rather than a full neighborhood.
Sure, I mean, if I have it at every point, then of course I'm going to get a... I'm sorry? No, of course, it's zero, right? I mean, you know, you are just getting zero everywhere in a neighborhood, right? But you cannot extend it globally in general, right? Because to extend it globally, you need constantly this kind of information about this null convexity. You see, this null convexity type, this is a highly non-trivial thing. And in fact, it turns out, I think I told you last time, it turns out that the main obstacle to prove null convexity is the presence of null geodesics, which are, so in the rigidity problem, it's the presence of trapped null geodesics. The trapped null geodesics are the ones that give you problems. Right? So,
but not in the remaining case.
In the remaining case, there is nothing. In the remaining case, there is.
Killing vector field, in the Ricci flat remaining manifolds. In the domain that you get.
You can extend it, yeah. Right, exactly. Yeah, because null convexity is automatically satisfied. Yeah, that's true. Okay. And you get a global result, in fact, right? Okay, so any other question? Right. Okay, so let's go on. So unique continuation to conclude that W and pi vanish in the neighborhood of Z, and of course P. And of course, the role of null convexity, which is, as we said, it's essential because that's the only way to treat this equation, okay, for W. All right. So now let's talk about a counterexample because I think, I think the counterexample, the way we do it, you'll see, it's tied to the rigidity problem. But I think the counterexample can be done also here in this general case. Right? So I think if you have a point P where you don't have strict null convexity, but in fact you can get here equality at the point P, then you don't have the result. Okay, so in other words, unique continuation fails in that case. So let's look at an example, because I think it's a very, this is a very nice example. So this is slightly more general. By the way, this theorem also can be extended in the following way. If I assume that I have another Killing vector field, say T, an arbitrary Killing vector field, T, defined everywhere on the manifold, right? So this is now defined everywhere. And I look at Killing vector field here which commutes T. And I want to extend it. I want to extend Z so that it still commutes T outside, right? So in other words, I want to get a Killing vector field now, extend it, get a Killing vector field which also commutes T. Then instead of having this strict null convexity verified, I need the strict T null convexity. Right? So in other words, the assumptions that I need in that case is slightly less, right? I mean, right? So which is natural, because if T has a Killing vector field in some sense, that you know, you expect that this should be easier to extend, right? Okay, because you have a symmetry. Okay. Anyway, so this is another result that you can prove using exactly the same techniques. The only thing in that case, I mean, the only difference is that at the end of the day, you have to use this T null convexity, and that's where you use it. Okay. Anyway, so that's okay. So now I want to go back to the rigidity problem. So the result which I just showed you shows that if I look at a black hole with this bifurcate horizon, right, then the null convexity condition is verified at this point, and therefore I can extend the Hawking vector field, which was defined here. I can extend it slightly inside, okay, and therefore I get now a whole neighborhood of the horizon in which the Hawking vector field has been extended. Okay, I want to convince you that such a result is essential. It's essential in proving such a result, essential to use a bifurcation. If I try to get another point here, I try to prove uniqueness at the point on the null hypersurface, then it will fail. So here is a theorem. So there exists a smooth stationary extension. So imagine that on the left here we have the Kerr, the usual Kerr, right? And I'm talking about extending the Hawking vector field in the interior, in the exterior, right? So I have the Hawking vector field here, and I want to extend it. In fact, I'm going to say something. I'm going to say this slightly differently. Assume that I have Kerr here. So of course, Kerr is axially symmetric, and I want to extend the axial symmetry outside. In other words, in this region, in the exterior region. So I have it here. I want to extend it here. So the claim is that there exists a smooth stationary extensions of the Kerr here for a between 0 and m. I want to exclude them because that's the extreme case where the but anyway, it's probably not important actually. Locally defining a neighborhood of a point on the horizon. So I define a neighborhood on the point not on the bifurcation sphere, but at a point on the horizon. So locally defining a neighborhood of a point on the horizon, P, which is not on the bifurcation, which failed to be axis symmetric. So again, the remarkable thing is that I find the extension which are stationary. They are extensions of Kerr, so Kerr has additional axis symmetric vector field. But the extension fails to be axis symmetric. And of course, this is only true if you don't have analyticity. In the case of analyticity, the Hawking result tells you that the additional symmetry can be extended. But if you don't have analyticity, this result shows you that the whole philosophy of Hawking will fail, right? Because you cannot extend locally from the horizon. So the information from the horizon does not transmit inside. Okay, so what's the idea? We have to modify the Kerr metric G smoothly across the horizon. So I have the metric here. I want to extend it smoothly across the horizon such that I'm still Ricci flat, right? So the extension is going to be Ricci flat. It's going to be stationary. In other words, the stationary vector field of Kerr extends across, okay, so remains killing. Yet G admits no killing extensions of the vector field Z, which is the axially symmetric vector field of Kerr, right? Is the statement clear? Right? So, in other words, the claim is that there exist extensions of Kerr which verify the Einstein equation, so they are vacuum extensions. They are stationary in the sense that they are still T remains a killing vector field, but Z, the extension of Z, is not true. Okay? So Z cannot be extended, which of course contradicts completely the philosophy of Hawking. Right? Okay. So the reason, the deep reason this is not true, yes?
Can there be other killing vectors, or do you know there?
Probably not. I mean, yeah. Most probably not. I mean, you know, killing vector fields, if they exist, they are very rare, right? So you are showing here that the extension of Z doesn't make any sense. Yeah, and there would be no other killing vector.
Just one more thing. Can you do the external case as well? The A equal M case? Because that's a situation because there's no bifurcation.
I think so. I think so, yeah. Yeah, I think that is not important, yeah. That is not important. So the deep reason why this is true is because the null convexity condition is not verified at this point. Okay? So null convexity, in fact, it's very easy to see that if you have a null hypersurface, because the horizon is a null hypersurface, if you have a null hypersurface, this condition, this will be equal to zero, in fact. And it's very easy to check. Okay? So null convexity fails by very little, but you know it's sufficient to have a catastrophic impact on Hawking's rigidity philosophy, right? You can simply not extend things. Okay. Okay, so let's see how the proof goes. So the moral is of hope is, of course, that there is no hope to construct an additional symmetry as in Hawking rigidity theorem by relying only on local information. I mean, relying only on local information here, you cannot do it. And again, the result, I think, can be done in full generality. We haven't done it, but I'm sure that the result is fully general. Okay? All right, so let's see how we prove it. So it's a non-trivial theorem, because how do you show? I mean, the hard part, it's not so hard maybe to extend things to satisfy the Einstein equation, because, I don't know, you solve the Einstein equation somehow, right? But what's very, very hard is to solve the Einstein equation while at the same time showing that you stay stationary, right? Because stationarity is a global phenomena, right? It's not purely local. So how do you do that? So the main idea of the proof is to do a reduction. So use the fact that the extension has to be stationary in order to reduce the problem to something slightly easier, where you, in some sense, you more doubt the stationarity. You forget about the stationarity. So let me explain how this goes. All right, so here is the idea. First of all, let's recall a little bit, a few facts about killing vector fields. So obviously, a killing vector field, T, can be recognized by the fact that it verifies this equation. So this is standard thing about killing vector fields. And of course, Li T commutes with covariant derivatives, right? Okay. So now given a killing vector field T, I do some constructions. I construct the so-called F alpha beta, which is this one here, this funny F, which is a sum between F and I F star, that's a Hodge dual of F, which is very easy to define using the volume form, right? So you are in four dimensions, the volume form is a four tensor, so I can define the Hodge dual so that I get, in the end, I still get the same object as here, right? In other words, I still get an anti-symmetry. By the way, F is d alpha t beta, and of course, d alpha t beta is anti-symmetric, right? So d alpha t beta, as you know, because t is killing, this is minus d beta t alpha, right? Just from the fact that li t of g is equal to zero, right? So this is the killing equation, which is immediate. So So F is anti-symmetric, and therefore I can take the Hodge dual, which will also be anti-symmetric, and I form this complex two tensor, which is the rond F. Okay, then I take the so-called Ernst tensor vector, rather, which is defined by taking F lambda alpha and multiplying by T lambda. Right, so this will give you a one form, okay, which is sigma alpha. So sigma alpha is a one form. And then there is a very simple lemma that this tensor verifies this equation, which follows immediately from this. By the way, this this funny R is defined in the same way as F. So R is just I R star. So you can define the Hodge dual in the same way. And then you complexify and you get this kind of complex tensor. Okay, so that's something very simple. And it turns out that this equation is verified. This is immediately from here, in fact. This is the trivial consequence of this. Right? It just from the definition, just from this fact and the definitions of these things. But then the sigma alpha, if you are in vacuum, so here I need vacuum, if you are in vacuum, then the curl of sigma is equal to zero. In other words, d sigma is equal to zero, and therefore sigma admits a potential, which is called the Ernst potential. Okay, so this is this equation, and then there are these other two, which are also very easy to check. By the way, this should be F, not G squared. Excuse me, there is a mistake here. It should be F squared, F squared. In other words, the F being exactly this one. Anyway, but the important thing is this equation. So this equation follows immediately from whatever is written on the slide and using the fact that Ricci is equal to zero. So that's very simple. Okay, so you get an S potential, and then the S potential, we write it, so it's a scalar, we write it as minus x plus iy, where x is g of zz. In other words, g of tt. Ah, there are mistakes here. So this is g of tt, is this term here. Okay, there is no z in this. Z, instead of z, we have t. Okay, so this is how we define the Ernst potential. And now let's talk about reduction. So if I have a stationary kinetic vector field, which is this t, and I have the Ernst potential x and y, so this is the real Ernst potential, this is a complex Ernst potential, then we can do what is called the symmetry reduction. Namely, the metric G can be decomposed into a scalar, which is in fact exactly this x plus I y, so it's a complex scalar formed with x and y. And a metric, which is a 2 plus 1 metric, I start with a 3 plus 1 metric, right? And now H is going to be a 2 plus 1 metric, which is defined like this: H alpha beta is x, right, times the original metric minus T alpha T beta. T is this kinetic vector field. And it turns out that H verifies an equation, which is the Ricci of the metric H, so the Ricci of this 2 plus 1 metric, so Ricci in the sense of the 2 plus 1. So I'm talking now about the 2 plus 1 metric. Ricci of it is equal to just the alpha times the beta. So it's a contraction between the alpha and the beta. And then phi verifies, in fact, what is people will recognize immediately as a wave map equation. It's Dalembertian with respect to h of phi is x minus 1 d mu phi d mu phi. Okay, so this is a wave map defined from n, the manifold n. So n, the manifold n is just an orbit manifold, right? You take an orbit of the original manifold by this vector field t. Okay, so all right, so this is what it is. And now the idea is, in order to construct a solution of the Einstein equation, which is stationary, all I have to do is to solve this equation. I don't have to solve the original equation, which is very complicated. But I'm not forced to do it because I'm looking at stationary solutions, and therefore I'm looking only at solutions of this equation. Right? Is that clear? So, okay. And now, you see, this is much simpler, in particular because I see here a wave equation coupled with Ricci. But you see, the Ricci in 2 plus 1 dimension is such that the entire curvature is determined from it. So if I know the Ricci I know the full curvature tensor. So in other words, there are no dynamical degrees of freedom left except the ones that are expressed in this wave equation. In fact, it's not even a wave equation, because when t is time-like, it's going to be elliptic. It's going to be a Laplace equation, right? Okay. But this is actually very important, because I'm only going to solve it in the case when it's hyperbolic. In the elliptic case, I can't do anything, right? So it's in the hyperbolic case that I'm interested. And I'm interested in the hyperbolic case because, again, the picture, you see, the picture is that I'm looking at the point on the horizon, and I assume that I have an ergo region. In other words, I assume that the T here is actually space-like. So therefore, it's going to be space-like in a neighborhood, and therefore, I'm going to solve a hyperbolic equation rather than an elliptic equation. It's very important because, for example, if I'm in the Schwarzschild case, when A is equal to 0, I cannot do this. Because in that case, there is no wave equation. It's a degenerate elliptic equation. So in fact, the result is stated only for A strictly larger than 0, as you see it here. For A equal to 0, I don't know if it's true. We don't know, because again, in that case, the entire philosophy of the proof sort of breaks down. So the philosophy of the proof is that I construct solutions for this equation, because this equation is hyperbolic, and I can solve the characteristic problem for it. So the idea is that, what does it mean that I solve the characteristic problem? You see, I have my picture here. So let's say I take a point on this. It doesn't matter if I take one here or one here. Then you see I can draw another characteristic here, right? And then solve the characteristic problem with data here and here. The data, of course, on this side, the data is determined because this is where I'm on the Kerr. So this has to be the Kerr data. But here I am free to impose whatever I want. Right? Okay, so is that clear? So I'm solving, the idea is that I'm solving this equation with data on a characteristic hypersurface which is transversal to the horizon. And I have the freedom to pick whatever I want there. You know, of course, there has to be some compatibility around here, obviously, but that's easy to enforce, these compatibility conditions. But otherwise, I can take very general characteristic data here. So, of course, we all know that we can solve the characteristic initial value problem, not just the initial value problem. The characteristic value problem can be solved, and therefore, I can construct in a small neighborhood. Obviously, the neighborhood has to be very small, because I can only do it as long as I'm in the ergo region, right? It's essential that T has to be space-like. Otherwise, this will not work. So I solve it in a small neighborhood, and I construct my space-time. So that's the idea. Once I have the solution to this problem, then I can do a reconstruction. In other words, starting with this manifold N, 1 plus 2, and the metric H, and this X and Y, which is this potential, then I can reconstruct my space-time metric just by this procedure. Okay? So anyway, it's something very simple. Let's not waste time on this. But you can always reconstruct. So if I solve this problem here, I can reconstruct the space-time, the original space-time. And therefore, now I get a solution, which is 3 plus 1, which is stationary because it's constructed from stationary data, and which, because of the generality, because of the generality of this initial condition here, I can easily ensure that Z cannot be extended. Okay? So it's a generality of the characteristic Cauchy problem that allows me to conclude that Z cannot be extended. Right? So again, it's something that can only work in the smooth case. It can never work in the analytic case. Right? Okay. Questions? So that's a general idea. So this is just a right, so again, this is how the equations look like. Right, so all I have to do is to solve this problem, but of course, when I solve this problem, I have to also solve for H, right, because it's a couplet system. So, but as we said, this whatever you have here is determined from X and Y. So if I know X and Y, I should determine. So anyway, you still have to prove something non-trivial, because obviously you have to do a bootstrap argument where you construct X, Y, and H simultaneously, right? Okay, so, but it's not very difficult, and I think it's a very nice illustration of what can happen if you go from analytic to smooth. Okay, any questions? All right, I don't know what time is it. Okay, so maybe I'll take another few minutes and then we take a break. Okay, so let's... okay, so these are local results, right, that we discussed until now. So we still have to discuss the global results. In particular, you know, the main result that if we are close to Kerr, and if you have stationary solutions which are close to Kerr, then you have to be in Kerr globally. Okay, so this is obviously the local results that we discussed are going to be relevant, but we have to do a lot more. Okay, so these are the two results that I will talk about after the break. So this is the conjecture is true if it coincides with Kerr on this bifurcation. So if I impose a condition which tells me exactly the condition that is satisfied on Kerr, on the bifurcation, only on the bifurcation, then I have to be Kerr everywhere. So this is the first result of this type in this smooth regime, which was proved by Ionescu and myself. And then together with Alexakis, we showed this other result, which is this perturbative result. Okay, so maybe I think it's a good time to stop. So I wanted to talk a little bit about these two results that I mentioned. So first of all, the result with Ionescu, which is based on a tensor. I mean, in fact, both results are based on this Mar-Simon tensor. So let me explain what they are. So the Mar-Simon tensor is a complex valued tensor S defined in terms of the curvature and dt. Dt was what we called f before, right? Such that if S is identically zero, then the space-time is locally isometric to Kerr, right? So it plays the same role in detecting the Kerr as a Riemann curvature tensor plays in detecting the Minkowski space, the flat space. Okay, so the theorem is that if you have a space-time which is regular stationary with event horizon, right? So it satisfies all the usual properties that you want for a rigidity theorem. Of course, smooth, in the smooth category, so there is no analyticity. If S vanishes on the bifurcation sphere, right, of the horizon, so in other words, you need a non-trivial bifurcation, right? So that's, you are in the non-degenerate case. Then the space-time is isometric to external Kerr. So if S vanishes on the bifurcation sphere, then you are in Kerr everywhere. So in some sense, it's very satisfying because it's a global result. You don't make any other assumption. But of course, the fact that S vanishes on the bifurcation sphere is not a natural assumption. But it's very instructive, nevertheless. So what are the main ideas? Well, S verifies a wave equation, first of all. So we'll see. It verifies a wave equation of this type, where D'Alembertian, so this is the wave operator relative to G. It's a covariant equation in the sense that it's a wave operator applied to the tensor. S is a tensor. And this is on the right-hand side. You have a multiple of S and derivative of S. If S vanishes on the bifurcation sphere, in other words, if it vanishes at a point here, these are the two horizons. If it vanishes at this point, then you can show that it has to vanish along both horizons. So S has to vanish along the horizon. There's something wrong here. S should vanish on the union. If S vanishes, I don't know what I wrote here. Okay. It meant to say that if S vanishes on the bifurcation, then it vanishes on the two horizon. And then finally, if S vanishes on the union of the two horizon, then you have to show that S vanishes everywhere here. So this is simple. To show that if S vanishes on the bifurcation, it has to vanish on these two things, is not difficult. It uses the geometry of the horizon. Okay, but it's a relatively simple proof. It's just a little bit of relatively simple calculation. On the other hand, this step that S vanishes here and here, it means that S vanishes inside, it's a highly non-trivial step, right? And again, it's highly non-trivial because you do have a wave equation. So there is a wave equation verified here, but you have, again, an nilpotent problem, right? So you have to use a unique continuation argument, and the unique continuation argument is not simple, as we shall see. Anyway, so you need this null convexity. So you have null convexity here, as we discussed. This is a general fact. Extending S a little bit in a neighborhood uses just unique continuation results for equations of this type. Right? So this is very similar to before. You have a tensorial wave equation. You know that S vanishes here and here, then S vanishes in the interior, in the exterior of the black hole. Okay, so that's a unique continuation result. But of course, this unique continuation result can only be done locally. I mean, you can only show that a small neighborhood of the horizon, right? Because remember that the result that we proved before was a local result. So you can only do it locally. And then to continue, now the continuation argument is very interesting because once you show that S is zero in a neighborhood, then you are in Kerr. Locally, you are in Kerr because Mar Simon detects a Kerr. So you are in Kerr, and then you do the essential observation that you need is that in Kerr there are no trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T. So in other words, T null convexity is true in Kerr. Right? So this is an extremely important observation about Kerr. Okay? So therefore, there are no trapped null geodesics, so therefore T null convexity is verified. Of course, I have to explain a little bit more about this, but the idea is that somehow this T null convexity condition will be verified here in this neighborhood where you show that S is zero. And therefore, you can use another unique continuation argument, now a unique continuation argument based on T null convexity. Right? T null convexity rules out the presence of null geodesics perpendicular to T, which are trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T. Of course, there could still be lots of trapped null geodesics. So the standard unique continuation argument will not hold because there will be, in fact, we know, in Kerr there are plenty of trapped null geodesics. But there are no trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T. That's sort of the main point of this proof. Okay, so let's now, main ideas again. Closeness to Kerr is measured by the Mar-Simon tensor, as I said. Local extension from the horizon without analyticity. The horizon verifies the null convexity condition, which is here. Therefore, we can extend by geometric Aleman estimates. As long as the Mar-Simon tensor is small, the second Kini vector field can be extended. This is called T null convexity condition. So this is a unique continuation in Kerr based on this T null convexity condition. So if T null convexity condition is verified, which means exactly this, so right, it's like before, right, the Hessian is less than zero, but in a you need only to look at x's, vector fields x, which are tangent to the boundary at point P, but which are also null and also perpendicular to T. Right? So it's a restricted condition. Now, in Boyle-Lincolns coordinates for the Kerr, the function h equal to r, so the radius of Kerr, verifies this T null convexity condition. In other words, on r equal constant, there will be no such null geodesics, trapped null geodesic perpendicular to T. And that's the reason why this kind of uniqueness results can be proved globally in Kerr. So if you are in Kerr, you have a system like this. You see, it's a system of wave equation together with an ordinary differential equation, just like we had before. System of wave equation. And the important thing here is that Li T of W is equal to zero. Of course, automatically, if I'm in a stationary case, and I'm looking at, say, the Mars-Simon tensor, the lead T of the Mars-Simon tensor is, of course, zero, right? So so it's this fact which connects you with T-trap null geodesics perpendicular to T, right? Because otherwise the full null convexity condition will be needed. But because of this restriction, I only have to look at this axis which are perpendicular to T. All right? Is that clear?
Well,
yeah.
What is the radius of Kerr? What do you mean by R?
R, theta, and phi, right? The usual coordinates. The usual coordinates. Sorry? The what?
The violet coordinates.
You call it violet? I don't know. I mean, the Bauer-Linkwitz coordinates, I call it. Right? The Bauer-Linkwitz coordinates. So in Bauer-Linkwitz coordinates, the function R is a good one. In other words, R equal constant is such that there are no T null trap null geodesics perpendicular to T. OK. So again, results with on identity. OK, so again, I'm writing the same thing again, but now I want to write down also explicitly what this Mars-Simon tensor is. So the Mars-Simon tensor is formed starting with T. You construct that F just like we did before, exactly the same F. In other words, you take dt plus Hodge dual of dt. That's a tensor, a complex tensor, which is anti-symmetric. That's called this F. And you look at this complexified Riemann curvature tensor, just like before. Sigma is a Ernst potential of T, right? So this is, we defined it earlier. So it's a Ernst potential associated with this. And of course you have F, F times F minus 1 over 3 F squared times this tensor. And this tensor I didn't write, but it's a very simple tensor which is constructed from the metric. Okay, anyway, never mind exactly what it is. The important thing is that S verifies this equation. So the derivative of S is equal to something which is proportional to S. So this is very important, right? That when you differentiate S, you don't get D of S zero. So if you look just at the curvature, you'll get D mu of curvature, R alpha, mu alpha, rho alpha mu nu, this will be zero, right? So this part contributes zero. So the only thing that you'll see is coming from derivative of this. But the derivative of this can be re-expressed in terms of the curvature and then in terms of S. Anyway, it's a long calculation. But at the end of the day, you find that though D of S is not zero, it's proportional to S, right? As you see it here. So because of this, unique continuation arguments can be proved, right? So I can use unique continuation arguments. Because remember, the unique continuation arguments can be done for general equations of this type. You can even include a derivative of S. Here I don't have derivative of S, but even derivative of S could be used, could be included. Okay, so that's a Mars-Simon tensor. It's a remarkable tensor. I highly recommend it. It's extremely useful for many things. Okay, so that's a Mars-Simon tensor again, the definition. So this is just a repetition. So once I have this equation, I also get a wave equation. I need a wave equation because unique continuation arguments are done for wave equations. We don't have unique continuation. That's an interesting point. We don't have unique continuation arguments for tensors. Right? So for example, if I look at the Maxwell equations and I want to look at directly at a unique continuation based on Maxwell, I don't know how to do it. I have to go first to a wave equation, and then I get something interesting. Okay? I'll discuss more about this in a second. Okay, so this is the condition that needs to be satisfied on the bifurcation. So this is a result of Ionesco and myself from 2008. I told you that some condition needs to be satisfied on the bifurcation sphere. So the condition is exactly this. You take the sigma and the f of t, right? So you take your t, take f, you look at minus 4m squared f squared equal to 1 minus sigma to the 4. That's your condition. So this condition is automatically satisfied in Kerr. And if it's satisfied on any stationary spacetime, then in fact you are in Kerr. So it uniquely characterizes Kerr. In Kerr, the sigma, this nth potential, and this f squared looks like this. Right? So if you have a Kerr defined in terms of a and m, then the nth potential has this form, and the f squared has this form, and it's very easy to check this condition. All right? OK, so then there is this other result, which is a perturbation result, which is obtained with Alexakis. The domain of outer communication of a regular stationary spacetime is isometric to the domain of outer communication of a Kerr spacetime, provided that there is a smallness condition verified. So the smallness condition has to be a condition on the Mass-Simon tensor. So if the Mass-Simon tensor multiplied by this 1 minus sigma is sufficiently small, then you are in again in Kerr. Okay? And this has to hold only on a Cauchy hypersurface, which the picture is like this. So again, you have to have a non-degenerate. You are in a non-degenerate situation, so you have a bifurcation, and you look at a Cauchy hypersurface sigma like this, which is space-like, of course. Right. So this condition has to be verified. The t here is. Yeah. So this is a frame. This is a frame, a general frame, and you only need it along this hypersurface. Right. So that's a condition. So S has to be small in some sense, and then you are in Kerr. So what is the main idea? So this is done differently. You see, in the previous result with Alex, we extended the Mass-Simon tensor. We showed that the Mass-Simon tensor, if it's zero on the horizon, then it has to be zero also in the exterior region. And there was nothing else needed. Here, the idea is actually to extend the Killing vector field. Right? So again, we know that there is a Hawking Killing vector field along the horizon, and that's what we want to extend. Right? So the extension now is based on the result that I discussed earlier. Right? So you can always extend a little bit. So if I have the Hawking vector field here and here, I can extend it a little bit. So I get I know that in a neighborhood of the horizon there exists a second Killing vector field, and then I need to keep extending this Killing vector field. So the extension now, at the beginning, the extension is this general extension result that we already had. Right. It's just that it's applied to this particular case. But again, that result was local. So I need to globalize the vector field. I need to keep going. Right? So in a first approximation, the only thing I know is that I'll have my second Hawking-Killing vector field defined here. And I have to keep extending it. And again, the extension is based on the notion of T null convexity. If I'm close to Kerr, T null convexity should be verified, because in Kerr it's verified. It should be verified in anything which is close to Kerr. And because of this condition, I can enforce that this T null convexity is verified. Okay? And therefore, I extend this Hawking vector field. I can extend it everywhere. Once I extend it everywhere, I have now a spacetime with two Killing vector fields, and I'm in the Carter-Robinson situation. So I can apply the Carter-Robinson result. Of course, I'm not quite satisfied. We are not quite satisfied with this proof, because it still relies on Carter-Robinson. You should not need Carter-Robinson. You should do it directly. But I think this is something that we should do later on, maybe. There's no reason to apply Carter-Robinson in this situation. But anyway, but that's the idea. OK, any questions?
Is Carter-Robinson, do you need the vector field to be globally defined?
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't just apply Carter-Robinson.
No, because there will be lots of spacetimes which will blow. So the rigidity theorem is not satisfied if you are not global, because in fact there are plenty of counterexamples of things that blow up later. I mean, you know, metrics that blow up. They are good in a certain region near the horizon, but blow up outside that region, right? So you don't have uniqueness. So to have uniqueness, you need global result. Okay. So any other questions? Okay. So the unique continuation. So we talked a lot about unique continuation, but how do you prove this unique continuation result? So I'm not going to go through all the, it's a rather technical thing, so I'm not going to go through all the details, but at least I want to give, I want to make some points of what is important in this type of results. Okay, so we are in the situation, the usual situation, right? I mean, we have a domain O, we have a point, we have this this null convexity condition verified, and I want to extend, I have a solution. I mean, now I don't have to talk about Killing vector fields because I know that the problem of extending Killing vector fields can be reduced to a unique continuation results for wave equations, right? So I can just simply look at some wave equation. For simplicity, let's take a scalar equation. And so this will be some nonlinear term, which is proportional to phi and derivatives of phi, let's say. Right? So, and we know that phi is 0 here. And I want to extend it. I want to conclude that phi has to be 0 on this side if this convexity condition is verified. Okay? So how do you prove such a result? All right, so this is based on Klainerman estimates. So I want to get I want to just give you a flavor. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because it's technical. But I want to give a flavor of the argument. So how do you do it? You take a point P, right, where this null convexity is satisfied. So I have my defining function H. And I define a weight, which is defined using an epsilon here, essentially, modulo some slight modification, essentially this weight is logarithm of epsilon plus H. So H is positive outside, right? So, okay. I'm only interested. So this will certainly be defined in the neighborhood of the point P. Okay, now what you want to prove is a Klainerman estimate. So you prove that there exists epsilon larger than zero and a constant sufficiently large such that for every function defined in the neighborhood of the point P, so this is the neighborhood U epsilon, so it's a neighborhood of size epsilon, if you think about it, okay? So depending on epsilon, it will shrink to something small. So it's a small neighborhood. Such that for every function which is compactly supported, and let's say C2 in this neighborhood, U epsilon, right? So for any function here, we have an estimate which is true for sufficiently large lambda. So if lambda is sufficiently large, then lambda times e to the minus lambda times f epsilon phi in L2, so the L2 norm. So this is a space-time L2 norm, right? So it's an L2 norm in the whole neighborhood, in this neighborhood here, right? So I take something which is compactly supported. Okay. And here you have derivative of phi. So derivative of phi, I mean, this you can define also for a tensorial equation. I mean, it doesn't make any difference. You can make it also for tensorial. But in any case, you take the whole space-time, and then you take take absolute value of the sum of the absolute value of derivatives, of all partial derivatives, right? So this makes perfect sense. And on the and you should estimate this in terms of lambda to the minus a half times the D'Alembertian of phi times e to the lambda minus lambda f epsilon. So that's the estimate. That's the main Klainerman estimate, right? And then once you have such an estimate, it's not hard to see that indeed, if I have a solution of this equation, which is zero on this side, it has to be zero on the other side. Of course, for that neighborhood, U epsilon for which the Klainerman estimate holds true. Right. So any questions about this? All right, so that's sort of the crux of the matter, proving such estimates. So how do you prove such estimates? Okay, so the first observation, this is a trivial observation, is that it suffices, instead of proving this, I can prove this one, where f is actually f epsilon. So f is the same thing. I just dropped the epsilon here, but it's the same thing, right? In other words, this function. Right? So I instead of proving this, I have to prove this one. That's a triviality. Okay, but then comes up the main point. Sorry, there should be psi here. Let me write it down. It's a mistake. So you look for you write phi. I mean, this is sort of a standard technique in this Klainerman estimate. You look t to the lambda f or f epsilon, if you want, multiplied by psi. Right? So you write phi in this form. And then it's a simple calculation to show that e to the minus lambda f times this gives you an operator L applied to psi and the dimension of phi times psi. So it's a second order operator applied to psi where L looks like this. Right? So you see it has its dimension of psi plus first order term. So these are derivative of psi. X is this vector field. And G is a function. Right? So again, X is d alpha f times d alpha. So it's just the gradient of f. And G looks like this. Okay? So this is just a very simple calculation. I mean, it's a standard calculation. Right? It's a conjugation type calculation. OK. And now, instead of proving this result, it's easy to see that it suffices to prove this result. So again, this is going from here to here is very easy. Okay, so there's nothing deep. Okay, so we have to prove this type of result now, where L. So you see, instead of having the Dalembertian on the right hand side, now you have this more complicated operator on the right hand side. Okay, so the next step is now standard energy estimates. So now what you have to do is standard energy estimates, and maybe I should stop a little bit and give you sort of a very quick philosophy about energy estimates. Okay, so how do you prove energy estimates? If I have, here it's a more complicated operator because I have the ambition of psi plus lower order terms. Okay? But let's look at just this case. Let's look at just the ambition of psi is equal to a function f on the right hand, maybe capital F on the right hand side. All right, so okay. So how do I prove energy estimates? Of course, we all know that we look at the energy momentum tensor associated to this, which is d alpha psi d beta psi minus a half g alpha beta times d mu psi. Right? And then you observe that d beta q alpha beta is in fact d alpha of psi times this f, right? This right hand side. So if f is zero, you get zero. Okay, so that's just a simple identity. And then the next thing you do is you look at the vector field. So the vector field method is to apply q alpha beta, to look at q alpha beta x beta, where x is an arbitrary vector field, and then take d alpha of it. So of course, we all know that what you get here is q alpha beta times pi alpha beta. Well, this is the deformation tensor of x with 1/2 here. Right? Let's call it just pi. So this is just the deformation tensor of x. And then, of course, I have x plus x of phi x of psi times capital F. Right? That's what you get. Okay? Okay. So now obviously, the next thing you do is you start integrating on various domains. So typically, you integrate between two space-like hypersurfaces like this. So you integrate in a region like this. And then you will get, on this side, you get just the integral at the boundary. So you get the integral on this part. So let's call this sigma 1 and this sigma 0. So you get the integral on sigma 1 of q of x and the normal, let's call it nu. So this is a normal to the space-like hypersurface, right? Is equal to integral on sigma 0, q of x and normal, plus a space-time. So integral, so let's call this domain D. So this is D of Q times pi plus X times F times psi. Times x of psi. Okay, something like this, right? So you are integrating all this stuff. Okay, let's for simplicity assume that f is zero, so I don't have to worry about this, but I have to worry, of course, worry about this term. If x is killing, then of course q times pi is zero, and you get the usual conservation laws corresponding to symmetries of the spacetime, right? And then, of course, we all know that this is extremely useful for all sorts of things, in particular problems of evolution. Now, the situation here is very different. Here, I want to make the boundary zero. I want to forget about the boundary, but the boundaries don't give me anything. In fact, as you see in the definition of the Kerr-Lehmann estimate, the Kerr-Lehmann estimate is applied only to functions which are compactly supported, right? So I'm not going to get anything. I don't want the boundaries, I want to disappear completely. And in fact, it's consistent also with the fact that I have information on the boundary for, in the original problem, I know that phi is zero, the boundary, right? So, and of course, I'm not interested in space like hypersurfaces. I'm not going to have any space like it's a completely different situation. So in fact, what I want to do, so I want to forget about these terms, but obviously I cannot forget about these terms. And here is where you want to ensure that you get something positive. Now, if you remember, I mean, for those of you who know how you prove boundedness and decay results for wave equation on black holes, on Schwarz or on Kerr, you know that there is a Moravec estimate. The Moravec estimate is based on exactly the same idea, that somehow you are using this, the positivity of the space-time rather than the boundaries. The boundaries are also not important there. Well, they are important, but they can be estimated in different ways. But the essential thing is to get a positivity of this term. So this is very similar. In the Kerr-Lehmann estimate, it's something very similar. You want to take into account just this. Right? And right, how do you do that? So again, this is the energy momentum tensor. And there is a general calculation that gives you a vector field x and the scalar function w. You form this quantity, which is q mu nu x nu minus. So there is a correction to this q mu nu x nu, which I had here. Very similar to what you do in black holes when you try to prove decay and boundedness. You get this kind of expression, and which is a standard calculation. And then you arrange somehow that the boundaries don't matter, but you get a positivity based on the fact that this F has some convexity properties, right? So the trick now is to use that weight somehow to your advantage in order to get something positive, right? So you want to get something positive for all this stuff, right? Okay, so this is a d mu p mu plays a role. Well, so you add a term here which depends on w in such a way that using also the positivity of the weight, the convexity of the weight, you get a favorable sign, and as a consequence, you get your estimate. Right? So that's all I want to say about this, because otherwise it's rather technical. So there is still a lot of work, but that's the idea. So the idea is to still use energy estimates as in the classical case, but it's energy estimates where the boundaries don't matter. So you don't care about the boundaries, but you care about this term. Right? Any questions? Right. Yes? So I have a review article here on rigidity, which is called Rigidity. So it's a recent paper, which is going to appear in Journal of Differential Geometry. So it's called Rigidity Results in General Relativity, a Review. So it's a paper with Alex Ionescu, so whoever is interested. There is a little bit more at the end on this Kalman estimate, so how you prove the Kalman estimate. Okay. So that could be a good introduction. Okay, so that's it. I still want to mention, before finishing with rigidity, let's talk a little bit about conclusions. So what are the conclusions? Well, first of all, we have very good local results. We have very good local extension results of Kinning vector fields. So those are extremely satisfactory, right? The one that I showed at the beginning is very satisfactory. But of course, when it comes to the global results, well, and also, by the way, we have counterexamples, which also is important to keep in mind. But when it comes up to the full rigidity conjecture, of course, the results we have are unsatisfactory. All we can prove is that if you are sufficiently close to Kerr, you are in Kerr, right? So it's consistent maybe with the stability of Kerr, but it's not sufficient. We have also a conjecture which I mentioned last time, which says that as long as you have a stationary spacetime in which there are no trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T, as we saw, trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T are very important. As long as there are no such trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T, then you expect the result to be true, rigidity to be true. And the proof, we don't have a proof, but we believe that it's, you know, with some work, we believe that that conjecture is doable, right? So that's not probably not impossible. It's not easy, but it's not impossible. I think the technology we already have is probably almost sufficient to prove such a result. But on the other hand, we don't have any idea how to rule out this trapped null geodesic perpendicular to T. So how do you rule them out? So in fact, you know, it's extremely important to realize that this gives you a very serious obstruction to proving anything. Because the presence of such three trapped null geodesics is very subtle. So in particular, it tells you that for sure you cannot do it by local continuation results. So in other words, everything that we did so far is based on unique continuation. Unique continuation will not work. Why? Because locally, if I'm in a region, in the ergo region near the horizon, and if I look at T or T plus Z, assuming that there is a second Kinning vector field, like for example in Kerr. So in Kerr, so I'm talking about the situation in Kerr. In Kerr, there is almost no distinction between T and T plus Z. I can always add to T a T plus Z, and I cannot recognize the difference just based on local consideration. The only difference is at space-like infinity, because T and Z look very different at space-like infinity. But locally, there is no big distinction. And now, because of this, you see, if I take T plus epsilon Z, for example, if I just make a small modification of my T, I get another Kinning vector field. And this one in Kerr has plenty of trapped null geodesics, which are perpendicular to it. In other words, if I look at T prime, there are plenty of trapped null geodesics perpendicular to T prime. Okay? So there are none perpendicular to T, but they are perpendicular to this. And because of this, since I cannot distinguish between T and T prime in this region, there is no way to prove a local rigidity result, to prove the rigidity result just based on consideration locally from the horizon. So obviously you have to bring in the situation at infinity somehow. And we don't know how to do it. We have another result. So the three of us have another result, which brings in some information from infinity, but unfortunately it's still a local result. I mean, a small data result in the following sense. That if you assume that T on the bifurcation sphere, in other words, the Kinning vector field on the bifurcation sphere, of course, in the bifurcation sphere, it has to be tangent to the bifurcation sphere. So it has to rotate like this. If the rotation is very small, then we can prove that, again, we are in Kerr. In fact, in a in a Kerr with small a, right? Small angular momentum. So this will give you a result for a very small, much smaller than m. So it's still, unfortunately, a result of this type, in other words, with the smallness. But this brings into account, so it takes into account information from infinity. So it's the only result I know which takes into account information from infinity. So that's another result of Alexakis, Ionescu, and myself. Right? So I don't know if it's, I mean, so in other words, there is some kind of global identity on a space like hypersurface between the bifurcation and infinity. And that global identity is very important. OK, so hopefully, maybe things like this can be found in general. But I kind of doubt. So in other words, I even have doubts that this full rigidity conjecture is true, as stated, that maybe there are some fake Kerr solutions, fake stationary solutions which are not Kerr, right?
But so could you prove it with a generality?
Sorry?
Could you prove it with a generality?
Of course not. No, absolutely not, of course. I have no idea. Yeah, it could be that those will be unstable, but how do you do it? I have no idea. So this is all for you, for the next generation. Right, I mean, one needs new ideas, in other words. OK, so let's talk about stability now. OK, so again, this is part of our mathematical test of reality. We have rigidity, stability, and collapse. And now we talk about stability. Is a Kerr family stable under arbitrary small perturbations? So this is, of course, maybe the most important aspect of this mathematical test of reality. Because obviously, if they are unstable, then there are no black holes, physical black holes. OK, so the conjecture is that small perturbation of a given exterior, Kerr. So in other words, if I take a perturbation of the initial data of Kerr, right, I'm only looking at the exterior part. So I take a space like hypersurface, like this, which is transversal to the horizon. I look at the initial data of Kerr, and I perturb it a little bit. And I'm looking at what happens in the future of the data. Right? So I'd like to show that in the future, I'm converging to Kerr, to another Kerr, because A and M, the final A and M, could be different. I might converge to another Kerr. Right. OK. So converging to another Kerr. So that's a conjecture. It's very simple to state, but very difficult to solve. Right? So this is one of the major open problems in general relativity, and of course, with huge consequences also for astrophysics, for physics, astrophysics, and so on and so forth. OK, so let's. So why? Let me explain a little bit why this is a very hard problem. You see, there are two types of perturbations. If I perturb a solution, if I perturb a trivial solution like zero, or I perturb a solution which is stationary, I get very different pictures. And the stationary case is much more complicated. So let's try to explain. So you see, let's take a general nonlinear equation. Right? So n of phi equal to 0. It's some general PDE. Right? And imagine that it has a solution, phi 0, which is special. So this is a special solution. In particular, for example, the simplest case would be when this is 0, and phi 0 is 0. So n of 0 is 0. And then you want to perturb a little bit. In other words, I want to look at solutions of this type, n of phi 0 plus psi equal to 0, where psi is a small perturbation. So obviously, you linearize. When you linearize, you take the Fréchet derivative. So this L is a Fréchet derivative of n at phi 0. Right? So you get a linear operator, which depends on phi 0, applied to psi plus terms of order psi squared. Right? So this is n prime of phi 0. Right? So the linearized equation, of course, are this. So this is L of phi 0 applied to psi is equal to 0. Now, again, if you are in the simplest case when phi 0 is 0, then this will be it will be an operator whose constant coefficient typically, right? So you can use Fourier transform, you can use all sorts of methods. But if phi 0 is non-trivial, right, it's a stationary solution, then obviously this linearized operator can be very complicated. And trying to understand the linearized operator can be by itself a huge problem. OK, we have two types of stability results. We have orbital stability, which implies for the nonlinear problem that somehow when I perturb a little bit, psi stays bounded. So it doesn't go far away from phi 0. Right? So this is one type of result. In fact, of course, you want also that it doesn't go very far away. So if I start up with a small psi, boundedness will also mean that psi stays small. So you don't get too far away from the phi 0 you started with. So this is orbital stability. Then there is asymptotic stability, which tells you not only that psi stays bounded, but psi converges to 0. Actually, not necessarily to 0. It could be that psi converges to 0 only when I make a small perturbation of phi 0. In other words, when I change the phi 0, because the final state can be different. So it's not quite, it's not that psi tends to 0, but psi, you have control, asymptotic control on psi. That's the way it should be said. All right, so in the constant coefficient case, it turns out that if you have general nonlinear equations, like, say, quasi-linear wave equations, then there is no way to prove orbital stability, in other words, to show that psi is bounded for all time, without actually showing that psi tends to 0. Right? So if phi 0 equal to 0, or constant, but phi 0 equals 0, let's say, you have a complicated nonlinear wave equation, like quasi-linear, then the orbital stability is useless. You cannot prove orbital stability without proving asymptotic stability. And this is the fact of life, right? You need much more information than just boundedness. Boundedness is by itself not enough. OK, so an example of this situation is, of course, equations, nonlinear wave equations. So you have, say, the ambition of phi. And here you have a nonlinear terms, which depends on phi and derivative of phi. And it could actually depend even on the second derivative of phi. I mean, in a more complicated, this would be the quasi-linear case. And in this case, we are interested in phi 0 being 0. So you start with the stability of the 0 solution. And of course, the linearization then is just the ambition of psi equal to 0, which everybody knows how to solve, right? We know how to solve. You have millions of methods by which you can solve it, Fourier transform or spherical waves. If you look at the book of Fish-John, you find explicit solutions and so on. So we have a lot of information about this. So in particular, we know that psi decays like t to the minus n minus 1 over 2 uniformly in subnorm. So the subnorm of psi decays. So nevertheless, it may well be that this is unstable, even though we have a lot of asymptotic. So even with a lot of asymptotic information about the linearized problem, it may still be that this is unstable. And of course, we know that this equation dt phi squared, right? This very simple equation in 3 plus 1 dimension does not have global solution for small perturbation of the initial data, right? So if I start up with small data here, time t equals 0, data so of size epsilon, so phi is epsilon f and dt phi is epsilon g at time t equals 0, then this blows up in finite time. So in other words, even a very strong notion of linearized stability is not enough to ensure nonlinear stability. And you have, we have a result that tells you that if the null condition is verified, so null condition in 1 plus 3 dimensions, implies global solutions. Global and, of course, stability. So in that case, we have stability. So this is to say that we need a lot of information. We need strong linearized stability, and also we need something about the nonlinearity. In fact, the quadratic part of the nonlinearity, which is this null condition. And of course, there is more to this because it's not enough to just understand this equation by using Fourier methods or using any kind of special methods that you have in Minkowski space. You have to understand decay for solution of the linearized problem, so the ambition of psi equal to zero. You have to understand it in a way which can then be applied to the nonlinear problem. And that, of course, has led to the vector field method. So there is a general method which allows you to get decay information by using energy estimates. So just energy estimates without any fundamental solution gives you decay estimates. And those are the methods which are used and have been very successful in the particular case when phi is equal to constant. So, for example, okay, so here are all sorts of examples. And so the issue is what is the correct linearization. So the stability of the Minkowski space enters into this category when phi 0 is constant, because phi 0 in that case is a Minkowski space, which is a constant in the standard coordinates. Of course, the story is more complicated because it's a covariant equation, it's tensorial, and so on and so forth. But we'll talk about it later. So I'll talk about the stability of Minkowski space maybe next time. But for the moment, I just want to give generalities about what's going on. Okay, so we had so the issue is what happens now in the particular case when you look for the stability not of a constant state, but of a stationary, a more complicated stationary solution. And let's take an example. So let's look at the simplest possible equation. The ambition of phi is minus phi squared. Right? This is an equation. This is not a nice equation, I should say. I mean, you know, whoever tries to convince you that this, I mean, there are lots of people studying this equation because it has interesting characteristics that have to be understood in order to deal with other problems. But it's a very good model problem. So why is it a good model problem? Because it does have special stationary solutions. By the way, this is the equation with the wrong sign, right? So it doesn't have positive energy. Of course, if you have positive energy, you don't have stationary solutions. So you have to look at the case when there is a conservation of energy, but the energy is not positive. Anyway, so there are these solutions which are just function of absolute value of x. So there are radial stationary solutions which are easy to write down by just, you just solve this equation. You solve Laplacian of phi is equal to phi squared. So this has non-trivial solutions in the whole space. Right? So this is in R3. And these solutions, there is a family of solutions depending on some parameters, which I'm going to write QA. For example, if I have one solution, Q naught, then I can get QA by looking at Q0 and taking a translation, x minus x0. Right? So if this is a solution of this equation, then this is also a solution by translation invariant. So I have plenty of solutions, and I want now to linearize around a given solution and see what happens. Right? I mean, unfortunately, you know, the problem in this case is not very good because things are unstable. But nevertheless, you learn a lot by just looking at the model problem. So if you mod out those unstable modes which exist, then it turns out that you can still try to prove a result of the type that if you start up close to one Q, one QA, then you converge to another QA, which will be another A. Instead of A, you'll have an A prime. Right? So in other words, the solution shifts a little bit. Okay? You can also have Lorentz transformation, not just translations. You can also have Lorentz transformation. But in any case, things shift a little bit and you get another solution. So that's the idea to have in mind, that somehow this is more complicated because you are not going to stay in the same, close to the same solution you started with. You get something very different. And of course, So there's been a lot of work done, in particular here in France. There's the whole school of Frank Mel, and Jeremy also has worked on this. So there is a huge amount of work in the last 15 or 20 years on exactly on this issue of stability of stationary solutions for relatively simple equations. They always look at scalar equations. Okay, so black hole stability. So now we want to do the black hole stability. Now, of course, black hole stability is now in this complicated case when you are trying to prove stability near a stationary solution, which is your Kerr. You're starting with a Kerr solution. And again, you expect maybe if there is stability, you expect to get to a different Kerr. So in other words, the parameter A and M will have to change. So that's one complication. But of course, it's much more complicated than the scalar case. I mean, the scalar case, I mean, this is nothing by comparison to the degree of difficulty that you get for the Einstein equations, because it's a tensorial equation. And even setting up the problem correctly is highly non-trivial. Okay, so anyway, so this is definitely a difficult problem because, first of all, linearization, the issue of linearization, which is simply in this case, it's not even clear in this case how to do it. You see, linearization can be done at many levels. It can be done at the metric coefficients level, it can be done at connection coefficients, or it can be done at curvature components, or it can be done simultaneously in all somehow by some scheme. Defining the correct linearization is highly non-trivial for a tensorial equation, right? Because it very much depends. See, if I have this equation, I already have coordinates, right? So if I have this equation, the version of phi is phi squared, well, I'm working in given coordinates, dx1, xn. Of course, if I change the coordinates, linearization may look very different, right? So. But I don't have to do it for that problem. But for the Einstein equation, of course, it's extremely important to keep track of how you linearize. And you want to linearize in a way which is as invariant as possible. Equations are quasi-linear, so it's a major problem, which, of course, this equation doesn't have, which is that the characteristics depend on the solutions, right? So, the characteristics are extremely important because the radiation is carried away along characteristics. Right, so you don't know a priori where the characteristics are. The null structure, you have to use a special null structure because you already saw that if you have a bad equation like this one will not have global solutions, even for small perturbations. So something special about the Einstein equations has to be verified. And this is at the nonlinear level, which makes it very complicated. What people have done is to look at the linearized equations, right? Now, the linearized gravity equations are complicated, and there are some results, but they are not very satisfactory. In fact, if you remember that I mentioned last time that the physicists claim that you have linear stability and even nonlinear stability just because there are no exponentially growing modes for the linearized equations, right? And that, of course, as I try to explain, this is really very far from any kind of stability, even linear stability. Certainly not very far from nonlinear stability. So just the fact that there are no exponential growing modes is not enough. There's been a lot of work in recent years for simpler equations. So what people were able to do is just to study the wave equation. So there's been a huge amount of work in the last 15 years, maybe 10 years actually. Yeah, well, maybe 12 years, I think, starting with 2003. There were some first results of Soffer and Soffer and Blue. I think this was 2003, 2005, in which they started to look at this equation, the version of phi, scalar equation, but in Kerr. So you put the Kerr metric here. And you want to prove something about phi, in particular boundedness, for example. Of course, this is not, I should mention, this is not at all, it's very far from the linearized gravity. Gravity is very different, but you certainly expect that whatever you get for the linearized gravity will not look too different from this equation. Right? It's much more complicated, but this equation, you still think that it's relevant. And indeed, this equation is already very difficult. So just treating this equation is very, very difficult. The reason it's difficult is, first of all, if you think of the vector field method, the vector field method works well in Minkowski space because you have a lot of Killing and conformal Killing vector fields. But on a Kerr solution, you have very few. On Schwarzschild, you have more, but on Kerr in particular, you have very few Killing vector fields. So the classical vector field method has to be extended, and in fact, it has been extended by a lot of people that I mentioned in a second. So you have a limited symmetry, but you have also ergo region. Ergo region means that the energy, the standard energy, is not positive. This is a huge problem, right? Because the boundedness of solutions can only be established if you have boundedness of the energy. If the energy is not bounded, then you have a huge, huge problem. So that's a huge complication, which, by the way, you don't see at all when the physicists look at exponentially growing mode. This does not play any role, somehow, the presence of the ergo region. And then, of course, you can have trapped null geodesics. Already we saw that trapped null geodesics play a role in unique continuation, but they play the same role in this type of problem. So the presence of trapped null geodesics means that you could have problems, serious problems. Right? There are serious degeneracies. And then there are issues that have to do with the horizon and so on and so forth. And then, of course, finally, to top everything, you have this modulation issue. Modulation means that you transit from one solution to another. And in this very complicated situation, I mean, transition in this case, in semi-linear equation, scalar semi-linear equation, is now relatively well understood. But in the case of the black hole uniqueness, there is no result that comes even close to dealing with that issue. Right? So, okay. So anyway, all this makes the problem extremely difficult. So here are some results. The only results that are known, of course, in the case of the Minkowski space, which is the trivial case in some sense, right? Because you have A equal 0, M equal to 0, so you have a constant state. In that case, we have the global stability of Minkowski space, which is a full nonlinear result. So that's nice, but of course, the case of black holes is much more complicated. So we have the mode stability of the Kerr family. This is Whiting, 1989. We have the stability for scalar linear waves, which is what I mentioned here. We have a lot of people. I didn't even write all of them. There are many more. I mean, there are probably, I should mention, about 20 people who have contributed to this. But the main ones, I think I wrote the software Blue Sterbens, Dafermos Ronjanski, Matsuola, Metcalf, Tataro Tohoneanu, Blue Anderson, Tataro Tohoneanu. Then there are some other results which are scattering results of dynamical black holes. Let me not talk about this because this is a very nice result, but it will take me a long time. Then there are stability for scalar waves for all values of A between 0 and M. So this is for A much less than M. And this is a recent result by Dafermos, Rodniacki, Schlappentoch, Rotman. So this is 2014. Which gives you a complete characterization of boundedness and decay. So you get the same kind of decay rates for solutions of the wave equation in Kerr for all A as you have in Minkowski space. So this is very encouraging. Right? But again, remember that the full black hole stability has infinitely more difficulties than this. I mean, so this is just one. But this is a very important aspect of the problem. Okay, so here is a result that I'm going to talk. So there are results by Ionescu and myself, which I'll talk about, and some work in progress with Jeremy Seftel. Unfortunately, I think I'm out of time, so maybe I'll stop here and I'll talk about next time. So here I wanted to say very fast why Minkowski space is stable. I talk about Noether theorem next time, and vector field method. Okay, and then I'll talk about these model problems. Okay, so I think I should stop. So next time I'll talk about some other problems connected to stability. I'll talk about the main ideas in stability of Minkowski space without getting into any details. I'll talk about the vector field method, and then I'll talk a little bit about these model problems with Ionescu and Jeremy. All right, so I'll stop here.